Now it's time for me to play a TV host. Take it away, Parth G.
Hey, what's up, you lot? My name's Parth, and I'm going to be talking to you about my favorite picture. Big thanks to Mr. Higgs for inviting me to talk to you guys. Let's get into it. The image that I'm going to be talking about is this one here. This was produced by a scanning tunneling microscope, or STM. In this image, what we're looking at is graphite. Specifically, what we're looking at is a layer of carbon atoms. Now, the reason I'm claiming that this is my favorite physics image was because I was lucky enough to produce images just like this in my second year at university studying physics. This was the first time I got to experience creating images on an atomic level. Now, if we're going to talk about this image, we need to actually understand how an STM works. An STM works on the principle of quantum tunneling. Let's imagine that this is the graphite sample that we put under the microscope. The top layer of circles represents the top layer of carbon atoms that we will be imaging. The STM runs a very fine, atomically thin, metallic tip close to the surface of our sample. On this scale, it looks like a bunch of atoms lumped together, but we can see at the bottom, it's atomically thin. And in this case, we're going to be moving it from left to right. And this is where quantum tunneling comes into the picture. Now, let's start by zooming in a little bit closer to the bottom of the metallic tip and the surface of the sample. In the realm of what we call classical physics, we can think about the electrons found in the carbon atoms in our graphite surface. In classical physics, there was absolutely no way for these electrons to jump across the vacuum gap between the sample surface and the metallic tip. This was forbidden because the vacuum gap acted as a potential barrier, because electrons would need ridiculous amounts of energy to get over the potential energy barrier. However, quantum mechanics is really weird. It allows electrons in the carbon atoms to tunnel across the vacuum gap into the metallic tip. This is quantum tunneling. Electrons moving from the graphite sample to the metallic tip through a potential barrier. Now, electrons are charged particles, and they flow upward through the metallic tip once they tunnel across the gap. So what's a flow of charged particles? Well, it's a current, and this flow of electrons is called a tunneling current. Super creative name, right? And one of the factors affecting the tunneling current is the distance between the sample and the tip. So as the tip moves across, the distance between the sample and the tip changes, and the tunneling current changes. This tunneling current is then what's recorded as data, and all of this data is compiled into an image by a computer, resulting in what we see here, my favorite physics image. I was, like I said earlier, lucky enough to produce images just like this during my time at university, but unfortunately, I wasn't allowed to keep any of them. Should have just nicked a couple. Anyway, thank you so much for watching, and thank you to Mr. Higgs for inviting me to talk to you guys. Cheers.
Let me present the next guests, Andew Dotson.
What's going on, smart people? This is an image from a particle physics experiment that used what's called a bubble chamber. And these are my favorite images of physics because if you know how to read them, they kind of tell a story. And I'm going to tell you how to do that. Now, with these bubble chambers, they're filled with a very special kind of liquid under certain conditions. Can you tell that I do theoretical physics? But when a high-energy charged particle passes through them, it vaporizes the liquid around it, which forms bubbles along the path of the particle. So at the end of the day, that's what you're seeing here. You're seeing particle trajectories. Now, the next thing is, why are some of them super curved? Well, they're actually all a little bit curved, and the reason for this is that these particles are subject to a very strong magnetic field, and that radius of curvature depends on the momentum of the particles. So very high momentum charged particles won't deviate very much, but very low momentum particles will. You get these spirals here. So all of that in itself, I think, is really cool. One of my favorite parts about this image happens right here. We have a charged particle that's coming in. For what it's worth, it's a negative pion. And then its path, it just disappears, right? There's no jets or anything that's like, oh, it must have gotten in a crazy collision or something. No, it just vanishes. And then two more tracks open up here and here. So what actually happens, in a manner of speaking, is that this pion interacts with the proton and it becomes two invisible particles. They're invisible because they're neutral. Like I said earlier, it's only charged particles that leave the tracks because those are what ionize. So if we go over to this image here, it's kind of what I just showed before, but rotated. We have the pion coming in, interacts with a proton, and it becomes what's called a K0 and a lambda 0, very strange particles. And then these two particles later on decay back into a proton and a negative pion, and then two pions here. Now, if I were to give you some random bubble chamber event picture, would you be able to look at the track and say, oh, that looks like a kaon track? No, you would need more information for that. But you can still follow the overall process, like when things decayed and pairs were produced and things like that, which is sweet. So long story short, bubble chamber pics are heckin' cool.
Without further ado, now it's pretty much physics turn.
Hey there, thanks for the introduction. Our favorite physics pictures have to be Feynman diagrams. They look as simple as ancient cave paintings, but contain enough information to calculate the anomalous magnetic dipole moment of the electron to more than 10 significant figures, making this the most accurately verified prediction in the history of physics. So, how do they work? Feynman diagrams look simple, but they are actually a placeholder for rather complicated expressions. The story goes like this. When we use a quantum field theory, we want to calculate fields going from A to B plus some scattering somewhere in the middle. Let's take the simplest example of just one field going in and one field going out, meaning we consider the propagation of one field. If we start with a scalar field Lagrangian like this and follow a QFT textbook, it will lead us to this expression, where the index 0 denotes the free field theory. Assuming we actually work with a free field theory, the interaction Lagrangian is 0, the exponential is 1, and the remaining expression is called the Feynman propagator, which looks like this, and we're done. However, when the fields can interact with each other, things start to get interesting. Remember, this is the interaction in the Lagrangian, where lambda is a small parameter. We can then expand the exponential in the Taylor series and get the following amplitudes. The first term is again the Feynman propagator, but the following terms are new. To calculate them, we must use Wick's theorem and pick out pairs of fields in order to construct a Feynman propagator. And we have to account for any permutation. Since this gets rather messy, Feynman had the great idea of drawing diagrams in his 1949 paper titled Space-Time Approach to Quantum Electrodynamics by drawing lines for every propagator and connecting the lines at shared space-time points. You can imagine that once we have a lot of fields to deal with, picking pairs in all possible combinations can get annoying quite fast. It is therefore often easier to draw different diagrams and converting them into mathematical expressions, instead of doing the Taylor expansion and Wick's theorem manually every time. The rules how to convert between diagram and math are called Feynman rules, and there is a different set of Feynman rules for every quantum field theory. They translate highly complex mathematical information into simple, elegant, and plainly beautiful little cave paintings. So that's pretty much it for our favorite picture. Let's see what the others have to say.
The last presentation is from me. Take it away, me.
The physics of my favorite image can actually be seen anywhere. You just need a pool. So I'll grab my Christmas bike and go to the nearest pool. To see the physics from my favorite picture, dive under the water and look up. This is what you will see. This is my favorite image. It's called the Snell's window. It's this circle here, and within the circle, you can see photons escape the water surface. So within the circle, we see the ceiling in the building. However, if you go over the circle, the photons can't escape the surface, and so we see the reflected pool floor. I wanted to show you with this shot here, but the lens isn't wide enough to capture Snell's window, sadly. But I got this awesome shot of me diving into the water. I could see it with my eyes, and you can also see it with the camera if you tilt it a bit, like this. Let me explain what it is and why it occurs. To understand why it happens here, I'll roll with some barrels. In the blue regime, the barrel will roll slow, and in the white regime, the barrel will roll faster. Here comes one barrel. When the end sticks out, it will go faster, causing the barrel to rotate. Another barrel arrives with a greater angle with respect to the surface. This causes the outer barrel to rotate for a longer time and send the barrel back into the blue medium again. The regime represents water, where light can move slow, and the white regime represents air, where the light moves much faster. Barrels represented photons. Let's imagine Mario sits here. What can he see if we send actual photons and not barrels out? The idea is somewhat the same. At smaller angles, the light can escape, but at one angle called the critical angle, the light will bend and align with the surface like so. And any light going in a greater angle will just bounce and reflect into the water, just as I showed you earlier with the barrels. Let's go to 3D to see why a circle appears. Here is Mario. What will he see? Let's draw the critical angle all the way around, and so everything within that angle will exit the surface and everything in the red zone will just reflect the water. It's my favorite picture because it shows some beautiful but fundamental physics hiding in our daily life.
I hope you found these physics pictures as cool and as interesting as I did. I want to say thank you to Parth G and thank you to Pretty Much Physics, and of course thank you Andew Dotson for joining this project It was really fun.
I would also like to thank my wonderful Patreon supporters for making this video possible. Thank you very much.
Consider becoming my patron for the price of pay what you want. The support really helps me to make better content. The physics is theoretical, but the fun is real. See you in the next one.
So what to do now? Well, you should check out Parth G answering search Google questions, or watch Andrew's video, If Dr. House Was a Physicist. Or how about learning laser cooling from pretty much physics? See you.